Hello friends, welcome to Pathological Concepts. Today we are going to learn about skin cancer. Now those who are going to listen the term for the first time, don't confuse with the fungal disease. So today we will learn about mycosis fungoides. Please note, it is not a fungal disease, but it's a skin cancer. Now let's see how WHO defines this. It's epidermotropic primary cutaneous T-cell lymphoma, which is characterized by small to medium T lymphoma lymphocytes with cerebriform nuclei. So guys, mycosis fungoides is epidermotropic. We will see the mechanism of epidermotropism, and it is primary cutaneous T cell lymphoma, which is characterized by small to medium T lymphocyte with cerebriform nuclei. The T cell here is T helper cell. This is T helper cells. Now these T helper cells are CD4 positive. And the standard abbreviation we use for cutaneous T cell lymphoma is CTCL. So one important MCQ, this is the most common cutaneous T cell lymphoma. Important PGMU question. The most common cutaneous T cell lymphoma is mycosis fungoides. Now talking about etiology. The etiology is unknown. And it affects adults or elderly, mainly along with children and adolescents. Also, male is to female ratio is 2:1, so males are affected more than females. Now studies shows that some patients have got association with human T lymphotropic virus 1 and 2, and also with Epstein-Barr virus. Now let's have a look how epidermotropism takes place. This is the demarcation between epidermis and dermis. I have drawn the basement membrane, below it is dermis and above is epidermis. Now see, in epidermis we have malignant T cells, which has got convoluted nuclei, the folded nuclei, and also we have CD8 or NK cells. And in epidermis, the most abundant cell is keratinocyte, as we all know. So what happens when there is malignant T cell in the dermis? These reactive CD8 and NK cells, they produce interferon gamma. Now this interferon gamma, it stimulates the keratinocyte and lead to increased secretion of intercellular adhesion molecule 1, ICAM-1. I am writing in short, it is intercellular adhesion molecule 1, and also a chemokine which is CXC chemokine inducible protein 10. And the lymphocyte has got receptor, and it has got lymphocyte function associated protein 1. Now this binds to this one and also have receptor for the chemokine CXCR3 receptor, which bind to the inducible protein 10. So this epidermotropism basically means the tendency of atypical lymphocytes to go into the epidermis. So here we clearly see that the malignant cells are going to the epidermis. They are also maybe seen in the upper part of dermis or papillary dermis. Guys, this is the mechanism. But this epidermotropism is present only in the patch and plaque stage of the mycosis fungoides. As the tumor advances and the tumor stage is reached, we do not find epidermotropism. There is loss of epidermotropism. So what happens next in the late stage of mycosis fungoides? See, in the late stage I am talking about, these malignant cells, they also secrete interleukin-4. And guys, this interleukin-4 is going to inhibit this CD8 or NK cells. So the formation of interferon gamma will reduce, and hence there will be loss of epidermotropism. Now, as these lymphocytes are going to the epidermis, their characteristic abscess is formed, and these cells which I am drawing, these are T cells, atypical cells in the epidermis, and there is a particular name for this. It is known as Pottrier microabscess. So guys, you know that Pottrier microabscess, it's basically collection of T cells in the epidermis. You also know the epidermotropism, and you have seen the stages. I am talking about the stages. Now let's focus on this stage. We have got three stages: patch stage, plaque stage, and the tumor stage. Moving on next. We'll also talk about the clinical features in this stage. So here we have got the stages: patch stage, plaque stage, tumor stage. Now the patch stage, here we get the red, scaly, well demarcated itchy lesion, or sometimes erythematous lesion. So the clinical presentation or clinical feature would be like, patient will present with rash or pruritus. So what happens in plaque stage? In this stage we have thickening and elevation of patch. So we find here clinical feature presentation as keratoderma. What happens in tumor stage? The disease progresses to advanced stage, and there is nodular and tumorous growth of plaque. So the clinical feature, if face is involved, we got a typical leonine faces. Now what is leonine faces? The image you can check from the net. Moving on to next, talking about histology, what we get in histology. Guys, in histology here, in the patch stage, we get lymphocytes and histiocytes mainly. And here we get in the plaque stage, portrio microabscess as seen. And in this also portrio microabscess is seen along with atypical cells. In the tumor stage, portrio microabscess is seen. And the cell has got characteristic cerebriform nuclei. Now, as the disease progresses from patch stage to plaque to tumor stage, here the prognosis of the disease is very poor. So it is characterized by triad, erythroderma, generalized lymphadenopathy, and Sézary cells are seen. These are atypical or neoplastic T cells. These are neoplastic T cells present in skin, lymph node, and peripheral blood. So guys, Sézary syndrome has got three, it's triad. The triad is erythroderma, generalized lymphadenopathy, and Sézary cells we are going to see in the skin, lymph node, and peripheral blood. This is what? Convoluted nuclei. WHO defines certain more criteria to define this syndrome. What are that? There is absolute, I'm writing it here. Absolute Sézary cell count more than 1000 per mm³. The ratio of CD4 to CD8 should be more than 10, and there should be also loss of T cell antigen, CD T cell antigen. So that was about Sézary syndrome. And one important thing is, it is very aggressive. So 5-year disease specific survival, 5-year disease specific survival is less than 25%. The 5-year disease specific survival is then 25%. Now moving on to the treatment part. How we are going to treat mycosis fungoides and Sézary syndrome. The Sézary syndrome has got poor prognosis. So moving on next to treatment part. So for the treatment we use topical corticosteroids. Second, we use nitrogen mustard. Third, we can use PUVA. It is Soralen UVA. Soralen plus UVA therapy. Next, we use narrow beam UVB. It is narrow beam UVB therapy, phototherapy. Now one Bixaro team. This is third generation retinoid. This is third generation retinoid used in the treatment of mycosis fungoides, and pregnancy criteria is, pregnancy category comes in the X category, so it is contraindicated in the pregnant women. What next we can do? We can also use electron beam radiation phototherapy. So electron beam radiation phototherapy can also be used. Now one last thing to note that about the mechanism of PUVA. This soralen, this is photosensitive molecule. It combines the soralen, basically 8-methoxy soralen, or nowadays 5-methoxy soralen. This is used. This is given to the patient. Patient ingests this, and this bind to the DNA. Suppose this is the nucleus and this is the DNA. We assume it to be a DNA. So this bind to the DNA, the soralen bind to the DNA, and when we give UVA radiation, it destroys this. So in this way DNA gets destroyed. There is formation of DNA adducts. Mono or bi DNA adducts of pyrimidine bases occur, and in this way the DNA gets destroyed and the cell gets destroyed. So this is all about mycosis fungoides and Sézary syndrome. And for any queries you may comment in the section below. Thank you.